All right. Welcome to the UVM Extension New Farmer Project webinar, Livestock Fencing, Common Mistakes and Options for Diversified Farmers. I'm Jessie Schmidt, and I work for the UVM Extension New Farmer Project and the Women's Ag Network, and I'll be moderating this evening. Our presenter this evening is Colin Kennard from Wellscroft Fence Systems. Between his work and having grown up on a working farm, Colin's experience has given him great insight on how animals interact and respect or don't respect fences. His experience with agricultural fencing products continues to evolve along with innovations in the industry, and he has an excellent presentation to share this information with us today. So welcome, Colin. Thanks so much for taking time this evening to be our presenter.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Jesse. Appreciate that lovely introduction. So I'm just going to, we have about 45 minutes to try and pack a lot of information in. So I'm going to try and go at a steady pace, but hopefully not too quickly. Go ahead and type a little chat. If I'm going too quickly at any time, just let me know. But there's a lot of information here, so it's going to be tricky to pack it all in. We'll go to the first slide. Again, this is mostly going to be about common mistakes, but first I'm going to go over some of the options specifically for electric fencing. I do want to just briefly tell you a little bit more about Wellscroft. Just a second here. We do, of course, a lot of different things. And primarily, we do a lot of livestock inclusion fences, so keeping any type of livestock in. In addition, we do a huge amount of predator exclusion. So anything that you're trying to keep out, whether it's a vegetable garden, an orchard, anything like that, you name it. Keeping bears out of beehives, that's a very big thing. So we do a lot of that. And then some other small niches that we get into are anti-bird netting for keeping birds actually out of vineyards and blueberry areas, as well as trellising supplies for those vineyards. So we are a small family-run business located in the southwest corner of New Hampshire. We have a working farm as well as our fence company, and so we've been testing these products and everything on our farm for over 30 years. Okay, so the first part is just going to talk about some fencing options very quickly. There are basically two categories of fence that you can really narrow it down into, the electric category and the non-electric category. So electric fencing, which is primarily what we're going to focus on today, is a psychological fence, all right? You can make that a much safer fence. Barbed wire, we don't see quite as much of that anymore today, but it's
Hey, Colin, it looks like we're having audio. Do you guys hear us now? Can we get a smiley face if it's back? It's back. Okay, sorry about that. Let's go back to starting at woven wire.
Okay, sorry, I didn't realize we lost.
I didn't either.
Okay, I hope everyone can hear me now. Just skipping back to woven wire quickly, we just said that it's a very physical fence, often 8 or 10 feet tall. It can also be shorter than that, 4 foot, 5 foot for animals such as goats or sheep. But it is a very expensive initially fence to put up. Over the long run, it pays for itself though, and it's a very secure year-round solution. Coated smooth wire, I just said, is a high-tensile wire that's coated over with a monofilament, often used in equine fencing for safety reasons. Very safe fence. The third one is barbed wire. You don't see too much of it anymore these days, but some people do use that with cattle, or they will run barbed wire through woods in certain places where it's a little bit more cost effective. And then the last non-electric fence type is a plastic or polymer rail, and that is also often used with equine fencing. But today you're here primarily to talk about electric fence or listen. So I'm going to skip right to that and tell you a little bit about electric fence types, and then I'm going to have some examples here. The first type of electric fence I'm going to talk about is high-tensile smooth wire. And again, this is usually a 12.5 or 14 gauge smooth wire. Oftentimes, people that are running high-tensile wire are doing a perimeter fence. And there are many benefits to that, and I'm going to talk about that shortly. The next type, low-tension, semi-permanent quick fence. What that means is basically a fencing type that you can put up and you can leave it up for a matter of months or perhaps even a few years. It is designed to, it's basically set up on small posts, T-posts, steel T-posts, or fiberglass rods, and you can leave it there, like I said, or you can actually, you know, take it down and move it without too much trouble. We call that quick fence just as a nickname, but we have some fence like this on our property that's probably been there for 30 years. And the reason it was put there is because back 30 years ago, there was some question as to whether we might expand that pasture, and so we didn't want to make a physical fence there. And by putting the quick fence in, it allowed us some flexibility in the future. Well, to this day, we still haven't done anything, but the option is there. The next type, polywire, tape, rope, and reel systems, similar to the quick fence, just that polywire and tape generally have a little bit less lifespan. There is polywire out there that's 10 years or more, but it's a thinner wire, and it's less visible. So if you're running something like this through the woods, it's a good idea to include a piece of or a strand of tape for visibility so that wildlife doesn't walk through it and take down your fence. These are also great because they can be reeled up and stored very easily. You can also move them around using the reels. And then the last type I'm going to show you is electric netting. Many of you probably are familiar with electric netting. It's probably one of the fastest, easiest, most convenient types of portable electric fence, and we're going to talk a lot about that. So I'm going to start this off. I'd like to know if our audience here, quick question for you, and you can, again, use the A, B, and C over on the left-hand side of your screen. The question is, what is your primary use for electric fence? I would like to know from you, so I can gauge this conversation a little bit better, how and why you might be interested in electric fence. Is it going to be for keeping livestock in? Do you raise goats, sheep, poultry, cattle, anything like that? Or are you primarily interested in keeping some type of critter out? Are you keeping them out of a vegetable garden? Are you keeping them out of an orchard? Anything like that? Or perhaps both. Many of you might have a garden as well as you might keep chickens. So, so far it looks like a lot of you are doing both of those things, which is not uncommon. So that's great. All right, so I'm going to start this, show you some examples. First, I just want to get back to, again, what a psychological fence is. Perhaps one of my favorite Gary Larson cartoons here, cow sitting on a fence. It's not electric, and he says, look, if it was electric, could I do this? Meanwhile, the farmer inside is about to throw the switch. So that cow, very shortly, will create a psychological fear of this fence because he's going to get thrown off of it from this electric. So that first category, high tensile smooth wire, here's an example. This particular fence is, I think, a six wire. It's hard to see the bottom wire, but this is a six wire high tensile fence. And one thing you might want to notice about it is on this corner post, not every single wire is electrified. And there might be certain cases for that. This is a POSNEG fence. If you notice right here, I put a little blue arrow next to a staple. That line there and actually every other one, let's see, this one down here, those are not electrified and those are a negative wire. So in effect, if you're familiar with POSNEG fence, basically an animal has to touch two wires in order to get a shock. Now they could be touching, they could be standing on the ground and they could touch an electrified wire like this one here and receive a shock. But in the winter, and we're going to talk more about the winter in a second, electric fencing isn't as effective because they're standing on dry, frozen ground. And so a POSNEG fence in the winter is generally a safe way to keep animals protected in the winter and to keep them from getting out. At any time, if you have questions about a particular slide, I can jump back and forth, and I'll leave some space in between here for questions. But so here we have some pigs in smooth high-tensile wire. This actually, what you see here is aluminum wire, and you can see little kinks in it. It's a softer wire, and it's a low tension. Usually, high-tensile aluminum doesn't have the strength that steel does. So when you run aluminum, you might be running shorter distances. With lots of different livestock, you can use high-tensile fence. The things you would want to stay away from are using high-tensile steel around horses, as I mentioned earlier. But these pigs, actually, they're in a pasture that was designed for sheep, but we're renovating this pasture. And so we've put the pigs in, and you'll see a photo, I think, in a little bit here about on the back side of this pasture, they're actually subdivided with netting. So these pigs actually have three different types of fence keeping them in. They have this smooth high tensile in the foreground. They have, you can see, a woven wire fence in the background. And then off to the left, way back, and you can't quite see it, it's out of the frame, but there is an electric netting fence. Here we have, again, this is woven wire, but I'd like you to notice the smooth high tensile wire at the top. This is, you know, cattle fencing, and if the high tensile wire at the top is an electric offset, we call it, and it basically serves a few purposes, but primarily it's going to keep any predators from really wanting to jump over. Also, people will run a smooth high tensile offset like this sometimes on the exterior about nose height for predators. If you have animals such as goats, I believe I have a slide coming up that will show this, but goats like to climb, especially on woven wire like this. And so if you put an electric offset on the inside, spaced maybe a foot out, that will prevent them from climbing up too high and actually, you know, making a wreck of your fence. So another way to use the smooth high tensile. So shifting over into the second category, low tension fence. Low tension, again, is rope or tape. Perhaps some of you have heard of maxi shock, which is a 7-strand braided cable, or it's actually twisted. And all of those types of fence are designed to be low tension. They don't require big, heavy duty galvanized springs like you would with high tensile. And they can be mounted on, you know, just steel T-posts in the corners, even fiber rods in between. So there's not a lot of strain on these types of fencing. Here's another example. These two that I have happen to be for horses, but you could very just as easily, you know, put sheep or goats or cattle in something like this. Notice there's one strand of tape at the top of this photo. And that's just to add visibility. This is a good perimeter fence. You don't need, you know, 5 strands to help keep horses in. But if you're doing a perimeter fence, sometimes it's a good idea to just add a little bit more safety for any predators that might be coming up. I'm just going to jump in. I see there's a question here. John, I think you're asking if there's any problems with pigs going under woven wire. And that's a great question. And what we did on that particular slide, I think he's referring to this one back here. I'm just going to jump back. That particular set of woven wire does have an electric offset that you can't see in this photo, and that would be one way to keep them from digging under like that. But it definitely is a possibility if you didn't have something like that. All right, I'm going to jump to the third category here, polywire, tape, rope, and reels. So here are some belts of Galloway cattle, and they're behind three strands of Intella rope. This is a 6 millimeter polyethylene product, and it has about a 25 year lifespan. So if you're looking for something that's going to last a while, this is a great product. Obviously very visible both in the winter and in the summer, and again, very easy to move if should you want to. Many folks will use this to subdivide on pasture. They'll maybe just put one or two strands, depending on your, if it's cattle, depending on the nature of them. Some people will keep cattle in with just one single strand, and that's fine. But for a perimeter fence, and this actually what you're looking at here is a perimeter fence, but you might want, three, sometimes four. Talked about the single strand. Here is an example. These are cattle in a single strand of tape. This is half-inch tape. Again, very visible. It does have a little bit less of a lifespan than some of the rope. EnduroSoft is another product that has a 25-year lifespan, but this, what you're looking at, they give about a 10-year lifespan, and that's primarily just because it's a thinner material, and over time it does break down to UV. The UV factor. So, again, this next slide is the gardens. We use tape and single strands in some cases around vegetable gardens. If you don't have small critters, and what I mean by small critters would be, real tiny like weasels. Woodchucks are pretty big, and these two examples that you see in front of you are more than likely would help keep out a woodchuck. It's not to say they wouldn't jump in between there. This, these fences here, you're going to want to bait, and we're going to talk about baiting when we get to the common mistake section. But, these are not designed to keep deer out. As you know, deer could very easily just walk over this type of fence. It's not to say that it hasn't been done, however, because when you do bait a fence properly, which we'll also talk about shortly, that attracts the animal over to it and helps develop that psychological fear that I mentioned in the beginning. So garden fencing, a lot of garden fencing is netting, which you'll see next, but this is another way if you just have a small plot and you want to keep out, some of the bigger critters, so to speak, porcupines and skunks and things like that. And then here, just again on the ropes, offsets and such, here's more rope. This is mixed in with the rail fencing. This is a product in between for horses. And you can see that the Centaur product, that's the blue, the white, arrow's blue, the white rail here, that's a non-electric product. However, in between, you have Intella rope. And these here are electrified. So this is going to help keep your horses from fighting over a fence, perhaps, or rolling up against the fence, which is a common thing with horses. So that pretty much concludes that section. And then finally, we have, again, the electric netting. Pretty popular, very easy fence to put up, take down. You can put multiple rolls together. These happen to be our sheep here. There's about 100 sheep here grazing in the fall on what we call hay crop aftermath. So after the hay fields, expired and we've gotten all the hay off of it that we can, it still grows. And so rather than just let it go, we make up for, instead of feeding hay, we'll just graze our sheep on whatever hay we can or whatever grass we can that's still left. And actually, I think this photo is taken in about mid-December. So this past year, we had a really, there was very little snow, so we didn't have to bring the sheep home early, and they were able to graze and save us money, essentially. There are 7 or 8 rolls of netting hitched together here, and this is probably the section they're in is close to 4 acres, I'd say. So this is a sheep fencing, sheep netting, sheep or goat. It's electro-stop, and it's 42 inches high. It has semi-rigid vertical stays. You can see those basically are these stays here, and they are kind of a hard plastic, and it keeps them from sagging. So this fence really stands up nicely, and it's great for when you're out. Like, this photo is of a field that's really not by any civilization, so we have no way of knowing if something is chasing the animals. There is a llama in here with these sheep, but it's extra security having that height and knowing that something isn't going to jump over without too much trouble. So that's sheep fencing, poultry netting. Really popular. A lot of people are getting into poultry or have been in poultry in a while. Grass-fed, you know, free-range poultry. Having electric netting is one way that makes it really, really simple. That you can move it very, very easily. You can give your poultry a new plot every day if you really want, or every week. This particular picture, this farm took an old hay wagon and they put some nesting boxes kind of underneath, as you can see there. And then they just drag this wagon around every time they move their chickens. And, you know, it serves as their eggmobile, so to speak. But it's great because the poultry can, they're protected. They have the netting that you see here is a small mesh, and that helps obviously keep predators from sticking their noses through. Poultry netting, you would want to get really hot, and in most cases, you're trying to keep predators out rather than your birds in. People always ask me about birds flying over, and that can happen, and it does happen. Some people clip the wings, so they don't do that. However, with the number of chickens you're looking at here, I don't think anyone would want to go around clipping those wings. So it's one of those things where chickens, they're only going to try and make an escape if they get bored. And actually, this photo looks like they're ready to be moved. But you'll find that chickens won't voluntarily jump over if the grubs and the grass and whatnot they have to eat is, you know, sufficient. Some people also have a guard animal in with the poultry to help keep aerial predation down. I see, is it Lisa maybe, has a question about whether this is solar powered. This particular fence, if you're referring to the poultry netting here, I believe this one is not, because just out of the frame is a barn where they have electricity, and so they run the insulated cable out from their energizer to the fence to power it. So we're going to talk about energizers in a little bit. Okay, here is another poultry setup. Again, fine mesh is the 3-inch vertical stays. So between each stay, there's 3 inches. And down at the bottom, the distance between the horizontals is about 2 inches. So it really keeps out the really tiny, you know, weasels or fisher cats and, you know, things of that nature. This is turkeys being raised for Thanksgiving at a farm nearby us. They have a small, very easy to move chicken tractor. This is actually just their hut, but they, you know, they surround the whole thing with electric netting so that the birds can have a bigger area to graze. Again, here's some more sheep. I put this slide in because I wanted you to know, even though you can't see the perimeter fence, this is a great use of electric netting for the purpose of rotationally grazing animals. We have some sheep and goats in these pastures here, and you'll notice they're subdivided by actually a few different types of netting. In the foreground, I'll see if I can put it out, point it out here, right at the tip of the arrow, there's a steel high-tensile wire. So there's a high-tensile fence that goes the perimeter of this pasture, which is about 4 acres or 5 acres. And pay particular attention to right there, where I just moved the arrow. That is the tab on the netting clipping right onto a high-tensile fence. And so by having a perimeter fence, no matter what type it is, it allows you a way to connect subdivisions without having to have a separate energizer or a separate ground field. It's a really great way to divide up a pasture like this so that you can graze animals. And you can see that from this picture, the sheep were in this middle section not too long ago. We moved them over into the next one. And then the one beyond them, even in the background, has some flowers and it has grass that's been untouched. By the time those sheep chew this down and then get put into the last section and they eat that, they're going to be able to come all the way back to the first section, which is already starting to grow back here. So that's one way of keeping a field routinely grazed, and it's a great way to manage your pasture. The netting is not too expensive for doing this kind of thing, and it's always usable later on if you wanted to take it and graze them in a different field. All right, we have lots of different types of nets. This particular one here is for cattle. Cattle net is somewhat of a new product in the market, but nonetheless, it is great for temporary areas. If you have a big field, you may want to consider something like the rope or tape that you saw earlier, because the netting, for doing a large area, the netting will be more expensive. But if you have a small area that you just want to put your cows in temporarily, it's a great way to go. Big holes, you can see there's 24 inches between each vertical here, and there are only 4 strands. So with cattle, though, that's really all you need. This particular fence is powered by a PRS solar energizer. You can see the ground we're on right here. Clips onto the fence lead right here, and away you go. Really couldn't be too much simpler. And then the next product, next example I have for you is keeping beehives safe. This is really a big thing, and we've seen in our business recently a lot of people getting into keeping bees. And the first thing any bee class will tell you is you need to protect them because bears are out there, and they're hungry bears. So if you don't have something like this, bears could very easily and very quickly come in one night and just destroy your hives. So here's 2 hives. They're surrounded by, again, an electro net. This is a 35-inch product and has 12 inches between each vertical. But notice how straight it stands, and that's really great for keeping the bears out. Now, this really is where the psychological factor comes in, because you might be asking, how are you going to keep a big, strong bear out with this flimsy little electric fence? Well, it really comes down to that psychological factor, because once the bears touch the fence and you really give them a good jolt, they just don't want anything to do with it. That being said, it is really important that you bait your fence. And so we're going to talk about baiting, but that's just basically a way of attracting the bears to the fence. And some people will do that by taking peanut butter, putting it in some tin foil and wrapping it on the fence. Others have taken rags soaked in honey and actually tied them on the fence. There's numerous ways to do this, but what you're essentially doing is just attracting them to it to give them that education. So I mentioned it a little bit earlier. What about winter? So I have another question for everyone. Do you need fence in the winter? Do you personally need some kind of fence in the winter? Are you only keeping animals in the summer, and then are you getting rid of them, or are you going to be keeping them year-round? So if you want to, this is a yes or no question, so you should be able to just check a little box there. I'll give you a second to do that. Okay. That looks like a pretty strong response so far. So far, nobody doesn't. Okay, this is good. So, all of you need electric fence in the winter, or you need fence in the winter, let's put it that way. One thing I do want to make you aware of is that electric fencing, in general, is not as effective in the winter. That's due to the dry, frozen ground, all right? You have these animals here, these sheep, they're standing on snow. Snow is an insulator. So when they're standing on that, they're not going to be grounded, and therefore they're not going to receive the shock that they would normally. For the same reason, your predator, Mr. Coyote, when he's on the outside of the fence, he's also insulated, and therefore he's also not going to receive a shock. So it is something you need to keep in mind. It doesn't mean that you can't have an electric fence in the winter, but you just need to be vigilant about and take proper precautions to create the best perimeter fence that you can. This particular fence you're looking at, again, is a smooth high-tensile wire fence, and actually what we've built into this is the ability to switch it from being an all-positive fence, it's six wires, to a pos-neg fence. And there's a simple switch way over here on this post. It's hard to see, but it will, when you flip that switch, basically takes every other strand and it directs it to the ground. And so what happens is, as I mentioned earlier, the animal, when it comes over, it does need to touch two wires, but by doing so, it's going to be grounded with that ground wire and it'll receive a better shock because it, even though it's insulated by standing on the snow, it's touching that ground wire. This also, this is about a 5-acre field, and it's being run off of one 40-watt solar panel. And you do need to keep an eye on the voltage of your fence in the winter because we get a lot less usable solar light. So if you have a solar energizer in the winter, we have maybe in the northeast, and I think all of you are, most of you are from the northeast, we have maybe 3 to 4 usable hours of solar daylight. So you do need to be careful if we have a long string, a week or two of cloudy days. It's possible the battery that runs your energizer could drain down and, you can lose a voltage in your fence. So that's something to keep in mind. Next picture, as I mentioned, here's your dry frozen ground. Here's a good foot or so of snow on the ground blown across this field. This is a great example of that quick fence that I spoke about. This is just a few strands of maxi shock and tape, and they're strung on some T-posts and fiber rods, but I can tell you that if I were an animal standing on that snow, touching those strands, you really wouldn't get much of a shock at all, even if your fence is really powerful. So again, just keeping that in mind. You could rig this up so that it's also a positive negative. This happens to be an internal fence, so we're not as concerned about it in this particular example. This is just dividing one paddock from another, so it's not quite as much of a concern. And then the last winter picture I have for you is of netting in the winter. Again, not always recommended because with netting, you don't have that ability to flip a switch and change it from positive to all, from all positive to a positive negative. They do have, we do carry positive negative netting that you can have if you know that you're going to be running net in the winter. But, it's just something, again, to try and avoid if possible. This particular example, you can see that there was a recent snowstorm here, and the solar panel, again, is all covered with snow. So if you want to, monitor your fence, we're going to talk about that shortly, and you know, just be smart about this. If you, you know, if you have a solar panel out there, make sure it's facing south. Make sure that the snow is off of it so it can charge your battery. John has a question here, which is great. Will snow short out the fence if it covers the bottom wire? Excellent question. Generally, it will not short out the fence very much. It's hardly noticeable. Because it's dry and frozen and almost acts as an insulator, even though you might have two or three strands covered totally in snow, there's not enough conductive material in the snow to really short out the fence. If you had some other things in the snow, for example, I mean, if the grass had grown into this fence and then it snowed, I mean, snow is really not doing much at that point. It's still the grass that would be shorting out the fence, but you're pretty safe with it just being snow. Again, with this particular fence, and this is actually a quick ground net we'll talk about, but that very bottom wire that sits on the ground doesn't have any electricity running through it. It's the next one up that you'd have to worry about. And I think actually this strand right there that I just pointed out is the next one up. So you can see that's just about sitting in the snow. All right, so that pretty much wraps up just some of the systems that you can find for electric in the Northeast. Are there any other questions before we get into some of the common mistakes you'll see? Give you a second here. I'm going to go ahead, just due to time, I want to get through everything here, but I'm going to go ahead and start the next section. But if you had any other questions about that, don't hesitate to type it in. So here we are with the six most common mistakes made with electric fence. I'm going to try and get through these as quickly as I can. The first, improper grounding. Many times, people will come to us and they'll say, I don't have a big enough energizer, or you know, something is wrong with my fence, or something like that. I would say probably 8 out of 10 times, it's nothing to do with the energizer, and it's nothing to do with the fence itself. It all has to do with the ground. And the reason is because you need enough grounding to cause the energizer to push out its voltage in the path of least resistance. Now that might sound kind of complicated. What do I mean by that? The energizer, all right, you think of it, it has two directions it can push energy out. There's one here, that red knob, and that actually does go to the fence, and this green knob, in this case, goes to the ground field. The energizer is pushing out energy, and it wants to push it to whichever path, all right, there's two pathways here, it wants to go to the one that has the least amount of resistance. So essentially what you want to do is create lots of resistance in the form of a ground field in order to make or force the energizer to push all its energy into the fence. If you don't have enough resistance in the ground field, then it's going to say, it can actually be run backwards. It's going to say, all right, I'm going to put all the energy into the fence, I'm sorry, into the ground, and I'm going to use the fence as my ground field. And cases where that will happen, you'll actually see it switch. If you leave this fence, this is a poultry net you're looking at in behind here. Now, the lawn is nicely mowed, but what would happen in about 3 or 4 weeks, that grass is going to grow up into the poultry net. It's going to begin to short it out, and it's going to cause the fence to have more resistance. So what can happen is, even though you have a good ground field now, as things grow into the fence and it begins to short out the fence, that might actually become a better ground field, and the energizer will actually switch its polarity. So how do you combat this? One way to do it is to add extra ground field. All right, so you can add another one of these ground rods. This is not the best ground rod. So in addition to there being improper grounding, I'm showing this picture because this is a photo of steel rebar. Yes, it does work, but it's not the best option. We generally recommend a galvanized steel ground rod. It doesn't corrode, doesn't rust on you, and it's going to ensure a nice, strong connection for your ground field. If you do need to add a second ground rod, you would want to go 10 feet before pounding it into the ground. If you're any closer than that, you know, two ground rods just separated by a foot and put into the ground 4 feet is really only going to be as effective as one ground field. Each ground rod needs about a 10-foot radius to dissipate, all right, to absorb energy and dissipate. So if I were to add another one here, you want to put a ground rod somewhere where it's not going to be tripped over, you're not going to hit it with a lawnmower, et cetera, et cetera. Oftentimes, people will put it actually underneath the fence line because you're not walking there. If you're moving fence a lot, then you might want to reconsider, and you might not need to pound a second ground rod because if you're moving it, by the time you need to move it, and things are growing into the fence, then you know that takes care of the problem. I have a question here from Jessica that has to deal with grounding, so this is good. How do you deal with sandy soils and getting a good ground? Wonderful question, Jessica. Sandy soils are very tough. The best soil for grounding is a very earthy, moist, or wet soil, and not everybody has that. You're absolutely right. Sand is common. Sometimes I've had customers that have had to pound 5 or 6 ground rods in a row, spaced 10 feet apart, all connected in series, before they can actually get an effective ground. That's one way of doing it. Another way of doing it would be to find somewhere on your property that has the best soil that you can find and put your ground field there. And then if your fence is located 300 feet from that spot, you may have to run an insulated cable from that ground field to where your energizer is. It really, you know, it depends all on your situation. The other times that you'll find sand is next to buildings because they often, if the building has a foundation, like a poured foundation, they'll backfill the foundation with sand. And so it's not always a good idea to put a ground rod right next to a building. While we're on this topic, I'll also mention you should try and keep your ground field a minimum of 40 feet away from any utility ground. So your house has a ground rod, and you just don't want to try and keep your fence ground field at least 40 feet away because you can get induction. And we've actually had cases where people will start to hear the fence clicking in their phone line because the phones are picking up the fence pulse through the earth. So that's another tip for you. We have another question here from Rich about recommendation for moving ground rod often when using rotational grazing. That is an excellent question, Rich, and that's going to bring me to my next slide here. So here we have some ewes, again, on the hay crop aftermath, and we move them frequently. This is in the fall time. One thing I really want you to pay attention to is the bottom here by the energizer. This green lead that I just pointed to is clipped onto something, and it's not a ground rod. That actually is a metal tab, very similar to the metal tab at the top of the fence where the fence lead clips on. But in effect, the metal tab at the bottom has a series of wires that run all the way through the very bottom strand in the netting. That bottom strand is independent of the next one up and everything above it. So all of the positive, strands are above this line, but this one strand at the bottom can act as a ground. And basically what happens is you have a metal, let's say this roll of netting here, it's probably a full roll, the 164 feet. We may even put two or three of them together, depending on how big an area we have, but we'll need to attach them together, and then each spike that goes into the ground formed from the netting is in the ground, and therefore you're creating a ground field spread over a distance of, you know, up to 300 feet or maybe even more in some cases. So that's one really good thing about quick ground. If you're doing a lot of rotational grazing, rather than pounding a ground rod 4 feet in the ground and then yanking it out, which can be very labor intensive, quick ground is the way to go. pick up the pace a little here. I do want to just show you, this is an energizer. It doesn't have a very good ground field. This spike that's on the bottom of this energizer is acting as the ground field, but it's only going into the soil maybe 6 or 7 inches, which just is not enough for this type of netting. You'll also notice that the grass around here, it is morning, but when you have wet grass like this, it's going to create shorts in the fence even faster. All right, so our next common mistake, choosing the wrong size and type of energizer. Here are the types of energizer. You have your plug-in, 110 volt. You have a battery, 12 volt. You have something called a unigizer, which is basically both, 110 or 12 volt. It has an adapter for either one. And then the fourth one being solar. Energizers are measured in joules. So basically, that's the effective punch that an energizer gives off. And that's determined by the number of joules it has. A lot of times, you'll see an energizer that has a rating in miles. This energizer is good for 30 miles, or it's good for 60 miles. It's a very, very tough unit of measure because there's so many variables. You know, how many strands is it? What is the soil condition like? What type of animal is it? You know, different animals require different amounts of power. So we always go by a joule rating, not necessarily a miles rating. Here's an example of a plug-in unit. This is happens to be one that runs our farm. It's right now it's running about 36 acres of fence, and this is a 20 joule unit, so it's pretty significant size. Certainly not everybody needs this, but we have it set up here in a underneath a little overhang, just keeps the elements out of it, and we have a surge protector here. It's not plugged in at the moment, but a surge protector that it will go into, and then we have a two double switches to keep to be able to ground it in a lightning storm, which we'll talk about shortly. Here's a battery energizer. This runs on 4 D-cell batteries. Very nice, quick, easy little energizer. If you just have perhaps a 1 or 2 beehives you want to power up, this is a great solution for that. There's other battery energizers that will run on 12-volt cat car battery, or even some in between. This SpeedRite 1000 unit is a dual unigizer. It will run either 110 volt or 12 volt, which can be really nice if you're not even sure at the time what your situation will be. Perhaps you just built an area, you have a new barn, but it doesn't have power yet. Eventually it will. You want to run this on a 12 volt battery for the time being. You can do that. And then once you get power in that location, you can switch it over and run it off the 110 volt. In the long run, the 110 volt option is probably going to be cheaper, only because these energizers, even though they're very high voltage, they're very, very low amperage. They don't draw a lot. It's not like running a dryer or an air conditioner or anything like that. Absolutely not. These are very, very low. You probably wouldn't even see a blip in your utility bill. And then the last one here is solar. Again, these are common mistakes that I'm talking about. The mistake you see here, there's actually two mistakes. One, this is way, I can just tell you by looking at it, is way too much fence for this little energizer. Or conversely, this is not a big enough energizer to power this much fence. This is a 2.5 watt panel on a 0.21 joule energizer. And as soon as the grass starts to grow up into this, anywhere in here, it's just going to not be effective. The other problem that's going on, if you look on the right-hand side of the screen, there's a red lead, and it's clipped onto just the netting itself, not onto the metal tab at the top of the netting. The problem with that is it won't always create the best connection, and thus it won't power up every single strand, horizontal strand that's supposed to be. You want to make sure that when you connect your fence, using this lead, you clip it onto the metal tab at the very top, and that way it will transfer the power to every single strand. Again, solar energizers, some pretty common sense here. Face them south. Look at this one. It's facing the total opposite direction of the sun. I can tell you the sun is right over here. It's also under a tree, not very effective. Make sure you monitor the battery. If you're storing it in the winter, you should store it with at least a 70% charge. And then don't try not to ever let it totally discharge, because then oftentimes the battery will be no good after that. All right, I got to keep moving here a little bit. I'll get to some questions shortly. Improper training of livestock and wildlife to the fence. Here is a goat fence. This is a 3-inch stay, and you'll notice this little kid here could very easily put his head through this gap. But what we've done is we put an electric offset right here, about a foot away, to prevent them from going through. So we want to train the animals. Right now, I don't know if you can see, they are nibbling at some corn down here. This is the first time they've been in this pen. So by putting some corn there, you're actually drawing them over. It's pretty likely that she's going to bump her head into this strand and learn about the fence. Same goes with young animals. Oftentimes, like these lambs here, you can see them chewing on the fence. No harm. This is a non-electric fence, not a big deal. What happens when you suddenly, these lambs grow up and you put them in electric netting? Are you going to want them to chew on your electric netting? Probably not, because they probably could do some damage. However, your electric netting should be energized. You actually should never not energize your fence if you have animals in it, because then they can get tangled in it. By electrifying it, you're going to keep them from chewing on it. These next couple slides I have for you is how we train animals. This is one example. We'll put them in a familiar area. This is the barn. We have a solid paneled wire back here. And then just about a foot in front of it, we've placed one roll of electric netting. Hooked it up to a small energizer on a 12-volt battery. And you can see this young lamb here is coming over. It's kind of curious about the fence. And it's just a matter of time before every single animal does it. I think they bet each other to go touch it. There's the reaction from the animal right after she touched it. But I can tell you that if this looks mean to anyone, it really isn't. It's really, in the long run, this is the best thing you can do for them, because you want them to learn about the fence. You want them to know and respect it. You know, before you saw them chewing on it, well, now that's not a good thing anymore. One more, and then I'm going to get to a couple questions here. Again, training animals. Here is a picture of pig. Pigs are one of the few animals that actually, when they get shocked by electric fence, if they're not trained to it, they will actually run forward, not back up. And so that can be worse, because then they can get tangled in it. When you train pigs, I'm just going to jump back a slide. When you train them, it's a good idea to also use something like this with a more solid background. Even better than this panel here would be a wall of a barn, or we actually put our pigs in our manure pit, because it's a three-walled area, and we run a roll of electronet inside. And that way, when they get shocked, they can't run forward, because there's a physical, visible wall behind them. So they learn to back up. And then when you take that wall away and you put them just in the net itself, then they're fine. Okay, really quickly here, let's just jump over. Just had a question here from Rosie about how do you deal with rocky and hilly soils doing mob grazing. If you're talking about dealing with rocky and hilly soils as far as grounding, I would probably give you the same answer about needing to find an area that is the most effective, has the best earth you can find, and then you would want to run a insulated cable from that ground field to your energizer. All right, just a few left here. Improper lightning and surge protection. Quick question for you guys. Do you currently have any lightning protection for your energizer? So just go ahead and hit yes or no. If you have an electric fence, do you have any lightning protection? It's a good idea, if you have a perimeter fence especially, it's a good idea to have some lightning protection. Electric fence by itself is not going to be as susceptible to a lightning strike. That being said, it still can happen, but if you have a big high tensile fence like this one you see here, and it goes through the woods, and it's perhaps it's put on trees, there's a very good chance that lightning could hit a tree, could travel down the tree, along the fence wire, even miles, and get all the way back to your energizer and do some damage to your energizer. So there are a few precautions you can take. This particular picture of this lightning arrester is actually set up incorrectly, and so this is what not to do. This right here should be going to the fence. On this side, this should actually be going to your energizer. If you're putting a lightning arrester in line in your fence somewhere, there are different ways to hook this up, but this is not the way to do it because both sides are going right to the fence. Let's go to a quick diagram. Here's a quick sample. You have your energizer. There's a switch in line. From the switch, you're going to go down to your fence, over to the middle section of your lightning arrester. And then from there, it's going to travel along this coil and to the fence. So what happens is when lightning hits the fence and it wants to get back to your energizer, because your energizer has a really good ground field, which is essentially where the lightning wants to go, it's going to come into this junction. And what's going to happen is it's going to have a choice. I'm just going to jump back to that picture of the lightning arrester. Once the lightning comes in here, it has a choice. It can either go around this coil in 1/10,000th of a second and choke itself out, which it really doesn't like to do, or it can jump this gap right here and go all the way down to ground. This is where you would attach an independent ground rod. And that's, you know, that's one of the things that really will help save your energizer. Because if you don't have one of these in place and lightning hits the fence, it can travel all the way back to your energizer and, you know, do some damage inside. The other thing that can happen is lightning can come in through the 110 side. So if the lightning hits a telephone pole up the street from you, it can actually come back and come in through the plug. So it's a good idea to have a surge protector in place before you plug in your energizer. Here's a better picture of that lightning diverter and arrester. So from the fence, if lightning were to come in, again, here's the choice it has. It can go to the coil, back to the energizer, or it can jump this gap. And it's really going to often want to jump this gap. After this point, from the energizer, you would want to have a switch in between. And I believe I have a slide in the next picture to show you that. So here we have a switch. In the event of a lightning storm, if you know it's coming, you can go out to your energizer, unplug it, and take this switch and put it down into ground. That will ground out your fence. It will remove your energizer from the situation and keep it safe. One thing I must stress, though, is don't ever try and do this during a lightning storm. You don't want to be out there. It's not worth it. Let it go. But if you know a storm is coming, that's something that you can do. All right. We're almost there. I've got to keep up the pace. Not monitoring the voltage and the condition of the fence. Here's a picture of a very old lead. This is all rusty. This is something that would want to be replaced. There are many ways to test a fence. Here's just a quick sample of some of the testers that we offer. Simple multi-light fence testers, and then we have some that are a little more fancy, the digital testers, range from $15 up to this fault finder here is $130. So it all depends on what you want to spend and what you're doing, but it's a good idea to have something because it can help you just keep an eye on the fence and monitor the voltage. You get into situations like this one here with grass growing up into the netting, it's really going to short it out quickly. Again, with pigs, here's an example of pigs pushing all kinds of debris onto the net. This netting is going to lose its voltage very quickly because, you know, there's all these shorts in the fence. There's sticks on it, there's wet grass on it. So having a tester, testing your fence is always a good thing. You should do that routinely. Grass can grow sometimes quicker than you think, and you know, you might go out there one day and suddenly there's no voltage in your fence or there's under 1,000 volts because, you know, maybe it fell over in one area or you know, there's just too much grass and vegetation growing on it. A couple other things that you can do to monitor the fence. These are two devices that will help. One is the fence alert, which actually you hang on the fence, and that will start flashing when the fence drops below a certain voltage. So if you forget to turn it on or a tree falls on the fence, this fence alert will start flashing at you. I'd put it somewhere visible, maybe outside a window that you look out frequently. The other option is a live light, and what that does is it flashes with every pulse of the fence. So it's primarily visible in the dark. You can't see it quite as well in the daytime, but it's a way to look out and see that your fence is flashing, is working. Again, maintain your fence. Here's some examples of what to do and what not to do. Attaching insulators right directly to a tree. Over time, that tree is going to grow out, and you can look at this staple here. Is almost pinching off that insul tube, and eventually that's going to break or cause a short in there. Same with the one down below it, this J-bolt here. It's getting awfully close to the tree, and just a little bit of water there, and you could have an arc and lose a lot of voltage. On the right-hand side of the slide, you can see there's a board on the tree, and then the insulators are put on the board. That is the proper way to do it. How am I doing on time, Jesse?
I think maybe you could go for another 5 or so minutes, and then we'll take some more questions and wrap things up.
Okay, that'll be perfect. So we're on number 6. This is the last one. Not choosing the right type of fence to do the job. As you can see here, we have some goats that have thought it fun to venture outside of their boundary. And I can tell you that this particular setup was a high-tensile fence, all electric. And unfortunately, you can see that the ground is really dry. They're just not getting a shock, even though I know that this fence had, I think, 7 or 8,000 volts in it. And those goats are touching it. There's wires right on their back, and they're still not getting shocked. It all has to do with grounding. This is a case where a pause and egg fence might help. But on the other hand, the whole point of this mistake here is that this probably isn't the right fence for these animals. Goats are notorious for getting out and notorious for being escape artists. So you might want to find or think, you know, install a fence that is really designed more for them. The picture I showed earlier of some baby goats and mother goat behind woven wire, that is a good goat fence. That's this one here. That they're not going to get out of. If you're going to have goats year-round, it's a good idea to have some area like this. It's, you know, solid, physical fence, and they're not going to escape. Choosing the right fence for the job. Again, here is pig net. This is a new type of pig net. It's only been out a couple years, but you can notice all of this debris and brush that the pigs like to root up. They're pushing it right out underneath the fence. And so that's not going to short out the fence as you saw in that previous slide. I'll go back to it now. This is what we used to use for pig fencing. It's an electro net, and it sat right on the ground, and it required a lot of maintenance. You'd have to routinely go, like every day, go around it and, you know, pick it up, kick the stuff off of it, because otherwise you just lose voltage. And if there is any animal that is going to test your fence and get out, it's pigs. Pigs are just, they're amazingly intelligent animals, and they know when there's no voltage in that fence. They can just sense it. So this pig net sits up off the ground about 6 inches, and it's great because even this bottom wire is electrified, but it's not sitting on the ground. It's, again, you know, elevated off the ground. So they can push all this stuff underneath it. It requires a lot less maintenance, and it still does the job. What I wanted to illustrate here, this is poultry netting, keeping some turkeys in. But one thing you want to be careful with bigger animals. Do you see, I'm going to point the arrow on this guy wire on the corner. That corner post is being supported by this guy wire. That's great, except for one thing. What happens when you have an animal, predator, you know, either a big dog, or, you know, coyote or bear perhaps, that wants to get at your animals, what are they going to do? They're going to surround, they're going to continuously walk the perimeter of the fence looking for a place to get in, you know, looking for something that's fallen short. What happens when they walk around this is they could trip on this guy wire, and therefore that post is going to fall inward, and then they might, you know, be able to get in. So rather than choosing a guy wire, the poultry netting is fine, but you might want to have a more substantial post in this corner. You might need to reinforce it with a plastic fiber rod or something like that. So again, just to recap those mistakes. One, improper grounding. Always check your grounding. It's a good idea to have a tester. You know, you can test the grounding ability of your ground field using a fence tester. Number two, choosing the wrong size and type of energizer. And if you're unsure about what type of energizer to choose, that's what Wellscroft is there for. We can help you figure that out. There's a lot of variables, as I mentioned, what type of animal, how big an area, what type of fence. Are you going to be expanding in the future? Do you own this land? Are you renting? Do you need a solar energizer? There's all these different variables, and it can be very overwhelming trying to figure that out on your own. So we're here for everyone. We can very easily help you figure out what you need. Number three, improper training of livestock and wildlife to the fence. If you don't train your animals and or your predators to the fence, it's not going to be as effective. All right? This is a psychological fence. They need to be taught you know, what it's all about. You can do that by baiting them to the fence, and there are several ways to do that. Number four, improper lightning and surge protection. Really important that you have lightning protection if you have a pretty substantial fence. And as I mentioned, one roll of net on a little energizer out in the middle of nowhere, you know, not always going to be a prime target for lightning because it doesn't have a very big ground field. Your 30-acre perimeter fence may have 6 or 8, you know, 8-foot ground rods in the ground, and that's very attractive to lightning. So that's a case where you would want some lightning protection. Number five, monitoring the voltage and condition of the fence. Again, have a tester. Always check it. You know, walk the perimeter of your fence from time to time. Make sure there aren't trees down on it. Number six, the last one, just not choosing the right type of fence to do the job. Make sure that what you're keeping in or trying to keep in or trying to keep out has the right fence to do that. There's a lot of different options out there, and it's important that, you know, you get the right one. Again, Wellscroft can help you figure that out. So I know I covered a lot today. That just about wraps it up for me. We'll take some questions. I do want to just briefly mention this is a timely talk here because we do have our annual fence clinic coming up in May. It's going to be in about 2 weeks from now. So typically it's the first weekend in May, and it's a two-day thing. Both days are repeated, so you can come either day, whichever one fits into your schedule. This year it's May 5th or May 6th. And from about 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. You can go to our website at wellscroft.com. There's more information about it. There's an agenda. The picture you're looking at here is owner David Kennard reviewing some of the netting options. He happens to be showing off the pig fence, actually. And it's a great time to, you can see all the people that are there learning. He'll talk about all kinds of electric fence, all kinds of non-electric fence. The afternoon session, the next slide, the afternoon session, you can actually, it's a little more hands-on, you can actually build some fence. You can demo the king hair post driver if you're looking to build a more permanent perimeter fence. All these things are there for you to learn. It's a free clinic, I hope I mentioned that. It doesn't cost you anything but getting there. So please take advantage of it. You don't have to register, but we appreciate it if you do, just so we have an idea of how many people are coming. Again, you can do that on our website. And that website is this, wellscroft.com. So that's pretty much it. I thank you all, and we're going to take some questions now.
Thanks a lot, Colin, for sharing all of that information. So much to learn on this topic. So It looks like a few questions are popping up, so now would be your chance to get some specific questions answered, a certain situation you might be dealing with. One question here from Doug is whether you're having sheepdog demos along with your fencing demos on those days.
Okay, that's a good question. During the fence clinic, we don't have any sheepdog demos. There's just too much going on for fence-related activities. So if you are interested in the sheepdog demos, if you go to the website, there's a link to go to the farm side. And on the farm side, you can go to the demo dates, and that has a list of all the dates where we will be doing dog demonstrations. The next one that is coming up will be this coming weekend, the 28th, and that's Gore Place, and that's in Waltham, Massachusetts.
I do want to mention before people start checking out here too that we'd love to get your feedback. I did put a survey link into this window here, and that's just a quick survey so that we can make sure the webinars that we're providing for you are on target and helping you with what you're hoping to get helped with. And also, if you would like follow-up information on livestock, livestock fencing, that kind of thing, you can put your email into the chat box. I'll capture those emails and send you some follow-up information. You won't be added to any email lists unless you want to be. I'll give you some options for getting on our new farmer email list, but you won't be put on any lists automatically. So if you do want some follow-up information, put your email into there. You can send that directly to the moderators by just clicking the moderator tab. And that would just be seen by me and Colin if you're worried about privacy. So any more questions out there? Someone was looking to see slide 54 again.
Sure, I can do that.
That was Rosie.
I think it was the slide that you were hoping to see. I think there was another question back here. I'm just going back. Jim, I believe you asked, Rex on corner post for high tensile. So I believe you're talking about, you know, you want to know the diameter, depth, bracing, see different setups than the traditional double H. If I understand your question, just, you know, wanting to get some specifics on the bracing for high tensile, there's a lot there, but basically, I mean, the traditional H brace is something that is probably most common, and your brace is always going to want to be about at least twice the length that your fence is high. So if you have a 4-foot fence, actually a 10-foot brace is recommended. Your corner post would be about a 5-inch diameter post, and the two end posts could be a 4-inch diameter post. That corner post would go in about 4 feet, and the others in the line post can get by at about 3 feet. Again, there's some variables there, soil type, height of the fence, all those kinds of things. That's, if you're thinking of coming to the fence clinic, that's a great time to get those questions answered in more depth, because we will actually be there and we'll be building some fence, we'll be building a brace, and it's very hands-on. So hope I answered that question.
And Colin, if someone is just getting started with livestock and you know, doing some rotational grazing, you know, is there a recommendation that you have for, you know, a kind of a lower expense option for getting started with some, you know, hoofed animals perhaps, or?
Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. I would tend to recommend something like the electric netting for somebody who's just getting started. Maybe let's say they just want to get a few goats or sheep, for example. They're not sure if they want to be in it a long time. Netting, you know, for $130 or so, you can get one roll of netting. For another $100 or so, you can get an energizer, and just for a little bit, you know, little pieces like a ground rod here and there, like small things like that. For, I would say, under a total of about $300, you can get up and running with a, you know, a good little beginner setup, and that's a good way to kind of figure out if this is something you like. If it isn't something you like, that's okay. And there are several options for you at that point. I mean, we have a 30-day money-back guarantee for our products here. But if you're trying something out, you know, and you go several months and you find out it's not for you, I can tell you that something like netting has a really high resale value, as does some of the energizers. So you shouldn't have any trouble reselling that material to someone else. But that's a pretty easy way to get started if you're thinking of getting into livestock.
Great. Any other questions out there before we wrap up today? All right. Well, I think we are doing good. Colin, thank you again for sharing your information with us this evening. It was really great. And thanks, everyone, for participating and being with us this evening. I see someone's having trouble getting to the survey. If that link's not working, I don't know why, but I will check on that and I'll email people with that. We do really appreciate getting the feedback. Also, this webinar has been recorded. It will be posted on our website within a few days usually. We'll also post a PDF of the presentation if you just want to look at some of the examples. That's a quick way to move through the information as well. So that will be on our website. I'll send you a link to that information as well when it's available. And thanks a lot.
Thanks, everyone. Appreciate your attendance.